Can I continue, ma'am?
Please do.
Okay, goals of squint surgery is mainly both cosmetic and functional. Cosmetic is for satisfactory appearance of parallelism of two eyes adjacent adnexa in all cases. Functional goal is to restore and maintain a good and equal visual acuity of each eye, restore and maintain normal single binocular vision in all cases. Timing of surgery: in an infantile form, usually the surgery is done after 6 months of old. In other forms of concomitant strabismus, when non-surgical measures are unsuccessful and when the stability in the size of deviation is achieved. Usually in a paralytical strabismus, 6 months of waiting period is advised.
Adila?
Yes, ma'am.
Let me ask a question of somebody there. Ah, Maitri, how do you know that in a paralytic strabismus, that is incomitant strabismus, that the stability has been achieved?
Ma'am, we have to measure the deviation, and using the HESS chart also we can identify.
Excellent. So you have a subjective way and an objective way. So an objective way is by your own measurements, and a subjective way is by the patient's HESS charting. Excellent. Okay, go ahead.
Absolute contraindication for squint surgery is when the surgeon has inadequate understanding of patient's strabismus problem, and when the child has any health problem, because it can affect the anesthesia. Relative contraindications are when there is deviation, variable or inconsistent, or when the child is young enough to get amblyopia treatment, or if any previous surgery is done on two recti, and again on third or fourth time, there can be more chance of anterior segment ischemia, operating a dominant eye, and operating a one-eyed patient. Preoperatively,
Dr. KMM, I have a question. Why do you have to treat amblyopia before strabismus surgery?
Ma'am, because what visual potential is there, we have to check that. If vision is not improving, then even after doing the surgery, that eye is again into the strabismus.
Doctor, first of all, strabismus surgery is not to improve vision. Don't ever say that anywhere. Okay? No. So first, yeah, correct. Answer is, if you do surgery in an amblyopic eye, chances are it will recur again. Okay, very good. That is if it is an adult patient. Suppose a young patient, why do you want to do amblyopia treatment before you plan the surgery? Any other reason?
Ma'am, after treating the amblyopia, there are chances of correcting that strabismus spontaneously if...
Okay, that's a good point. If it's a very mild amblyopia and if you improve the vision, maybe the strabismus will get automatically corrected. Good point. Any other reason? What is the ultimate goal of strabismus surgery? At least concomitant deviation.
Ma'am, binocular vision.
Very good. So if one eye's vision is less and one eye vision is good, how will you have binocular vision? Correct? So the first goal of surgery, surgical planning, is equal vision. So you aim for equal vision by appropriate refractive correction, and you aim for equal vision by appropriate amblyopia treatment. Okay? All right.
Yes.
Proceed, Adila.
So in preoperative evaluation, we assess the vision using age-appropriate test and to detect any amblyopia. Binocular status, full cycloplegic refraction, and correcting amblyopia is mandatory. And we have to measure the deviation using prism bar cover test. And surgery is indicated for static angle, not for a dynamic angle. In case of incomitant squint, primary and secondary deviations are noted and surgery is based on fixing eye. Communication with patient or parent. We have to make them understand that squint surgery is a major surgery, prevent them from having unnecessary or impossible expectations. Have to explain the surgery details and its results, risk of anesthesia, visual outcome in a cosmetic surgery, possibility and need of resurgery, because 10% of cases can have undercorrected or overcorrected. About the
Adila, Aman, why is it a major surgery? I mean, what are the dreaded complications of strabismus surgery?
Ma'am, anterior segment ischemia can occur.
Okay, when does it occur? every surgery, it can
cause. No, ma'am. When we are operating on more than like 3 to 4 muscles, if we are operating.
Okay, if you're operating more than two, and you go on to third muscle from then on, especially which patients are at high risk for antacid ischemia?
Ma'am, old age patients.
Old age patients and those with vascular comorbidities. Okay, what are the dreaded complications are there? Can you lose the eye with other than anterior segment ischemia? Is there any other way you can lose the eye?
Ma'am, risk of perforation is there.
Yeah, risk of perforation dealing to?
Ma'am, during recession surgery, it can.
No, happen. Dealing to what? Dealing, I mean, leading to what?
Leading to, ma'am, thysis of the eye.
Yeah, leading to retinal detachment.
Yeah, yeah.
It has to be stepwise. You can't do one perforation and becomes thysis. So either you can have RD. What else can you have by the perforation? Endophthalmitis.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah.
So any other dread complication which may be make the patient's life miserable? Diplopia.
Okay.
Yeah. Sometimes you take patients out of their suppression scotoma, you can induce diplopia. So here's a patient who had a squint and was happy. Now the patient's eyes are straight and patient is miserable. Because there is diplopia, there is torsion. Okay, you've created torsion. So these are dreaded complications. Okay.
Yeah.
And you have to explain. You don't have to tell the patient, there is risk of death and all that. But it's true because you do the surgery under general anesthesia as well. So there are anesthesia complications as well. But you must explain to the patient that it is not one minor procedure. Ha ha, we'll le jayenge, bas ho jayega 10 minute mein. That's not how you explain squint surgeries. Go ahead, Adila.
Anatomical considerations. Vertical recti is inserted slightly oblique. It has a slightly oblique insertion, 23 degree. Horizontal recti is but inserted. Its upper and lower ends are equidistant from the limbus. Except the medial rectus, other three recti have association with oblique muscles.
Wait, Adila. Let's have a first year. I'm not very familiar with the first year. Pranav. I know Pranav. He just finished Pete's posting. So, inferior oblique is closely associated with which rectus?
I'm inferior rectus.
Any other rectus?
I'm lateral rectus.
Lateral rectus, exactly. What about superior oblique?
Superior oblique is associated with superior rectus and also levator palpebrae superioris.
Okay, very good. Mostly it's under the superior rectus. So it's not really associated with the LPS, but yes, it's associated very closely with the superior rectus. Good. Proceed, Adila.
Yes. This image shows the insertion in relation to the insertion of recti in relation to the limbus. This shows that medial rectus is inserted 5.5 mm from the limbus, lateral rectus 7 mm, superior rectus 7.7 mm and inferior rectus 6.6 mm. Blood supply of anterior segment is via anterior ciliary artery, branch of ophthalmic artery. This is small 7 arteries which gets compromised when recti is operated. In surgery of both vertical recti in combination with the lateral rectus can precipitate anterior segment ischemia. This image shows the anterior segment circulation. These are the anterior ciliary artery. We can see that the lateral rectus is supplied by a single anterior ciliary artery, whereas every others have two arteries. Other important points are the sclera is thinnest at the insertion site of the recti, so care should be taken while we are suturing to avoid penetration of the globe. Preserve the muscle shape, preserve the tenons capsule because it can cause fat prolapsing and fibrofatty adhesions. Prevent damage to vortex veins, especially in case of oblique muscle surgeries. This image shows the orbital and facial relationship. This shows the muscle cone composed of recti muscles with their sheath, intermuscular septum, and adipose tissue both outside and inside the muscle cone. This is the tenons capsule, which is the principal fascia which envelops the eyeball. About developmental considerations, in a child, the axial length is 70% of the eye, adult size. Volume is half, surface area is 1/3. Anterior segment at the birth is 80%, and posterior segment develops by the next 6 months. So it is advised any resection or retroequatorial surgeries before 6 months will be unpredictable. Choice of surgery. Squint surgery is mainly two categories, weakening and strengthening procedures. Weakening is the recession and strengthening is the resection. Either in the same eye, the recession with antagonist muscle resection will be done, or both eyes symmetrically, recession or resection can be done. So it is not necessary to do a symmetrizing procedure on two eyes. The aim is to do a symmetrizing surgery. Now, based on the near distance deviation, in case of convergence excess, bimedial recession is advised. In case of divergence insufficiency, resection of both lateral recti. In case of a basic esotropia, monocular recession, resection is advised.
Now wait, Adila, let's ask a question. Ashok, are you here? Ashok Mondal. Akmal. Yeah, there you go.
Yes, ma'am.
So, why do you want to operate on the medial rectus in convergence excess?
Ma'am, after the medial rectus recession, the convergence will be the leisure. And
okay, in other words, in convergence excess esotropia, the large esotropia is for near or distance? The esotropia is more for near or distance?
Near, ma'am.
Near. So your choice of muscles often depend on the deviation is more for near or distance and whether it is esotropia or exotropia. So in esotropia, when the deviation is much larger at near, you choose medial rectus because medial rectus acts better or more effectively at near. Okay.
Okay.
Now, by the same count, divergence insufficiency, where is the larger deviation, at distance or near?
Distance.
Distance. Very good. And hence, strengthening the lateral, which is resection of lateral, is a better, maybe a better procedure. What do you understand by basic esotropia? How is the measurement for distance and near?
Basic, ma'am.
What does the term basic mean? Anywhere ma'am, the term basic means, usually it means it's the same for distance and near. Okay, so when the deviation is about the same for distance and near, and a child has a fixed, an eye that is preferred for fixation, suppose the left eye is the eye the child uses all the time, right eye is the one that is squinting more, but the vision seems equal, then you usually operate on the right eye. Once you've established the distance and near deviation are the same. So in both exotropia and esotropia, you use the word basic when the deviation is the same for distance and near. Clear, Ashok?
Okay, ma'am.
Adila, proceed.
Yes. In exotropia with convergence insufficiency, resection of both medial recti is the choice. Divergence excess, recession of both lateral recti, and a basic exotropia, monocular recession, resection. This shows the amount of surgical correction based on the deviation in prism diopters.
Adila, wait. Arun, where will I go find that? There is one, some sort of table she has given. Suppose I want to, so you've finished your DNB, you're out there, it's a simple basic esotropia, you want to do a recess dissect, where will you go find the table? Arun? Arun is not available. Okay, how about Ajiba? Where will you go find it? Yeah. You'll call Adila.
In one of our rooms.
Yeah. Or you'll come running to SN to look at one of the rooms. No, this is available in all the atlases. It's available in most textbooks of strabismus. It's also available on the internet. But this is a surgical table. Important. The reason I'm pointing this out is you generally should use one table. Okay. Every time you operate, you should not use different tables, because there is a minor variation even between the tables. And so if you want to look at your own results, you must generally always use the same table. Okay. So,
okay.
Yeah, you decide which table you want to use and use that same table. Don't operate one bimedial and then see that the patient is undercorrected. And tomorrow you look for some other table and do a little more. And then patient becomes overcorrected, then you don't know what to do. Not like that. Okay. So surgical correction amounts should be from the same table. Then after, say, 1 year, 2 years, you look back, look at your data, look at the outcome of the patients, and then decide whether this table is working for you. That's the way to do. Okay, Adila, go ahead.
Yes, this shows the safe limit of recession. This is the anatomical equator, which is the widest horizontal equator. It is different from the functional equator. It is 2 millimeter anterior for a medial rectus and 2 millimeter posterior for a lateral rectus. The maximum recession for a medial rectus is 6 millimeter, and for a lateral rectus is 8 millimeter in an adult. For a child, it is 5.5 millimeter is the maximum medial rectus recession, and lateral rectus is 7 millimeter recession. If you go beyond this maximum, muscle will cease to perform its action. The minimum recession is for a medial rectus 3 millimeter and for a lateral rectus 4 millimeters.
Okay, I have a question for Ashna. Why this maximum 6 millimeters? What is the thing? What is the deal? Why can't we do some more?
I don't know, ma'am. I think she said that the muscle will not function. Maybe it's not in the anatomical position.
Correct. Your arc of contact has changed so much that it may not function effectively. And if you have been doing, if you do bimedial recession, then you create so much incommitance. The lateral rectus becomes so much more powerful against so much weakened medial. So then the eye will be drifting out. That is one risk. What is the other problem with, especially medial rectus? You don't want to do very large amounts. What is the important role of medial rectus for daily life?
Ma'am, convergence and near work.
Excellent, convergence. So you will cripple convergence. So these patients will have a hard time converging the eyes, near activities. And these days we are so dependent on gadgets and so dependent on convergence. So these patients may be quite miserable. And like I said, you will have a setup for a consecutive exo. So don't cripple the medial. You can do large amounts, but not cripple the medial. Okay. Anybody, let me just ask you, I mean, anybody means nobody will answer. Now I'm trying to find a name that I am kind of familiar with. Okay. Lavanya, in which types of muscle surgery do you actually do even more amount, larger amounts than this? It's just a trivia question. It's not related to strabismus surgery. But you do operate on the muscles, but you do really large amounts. You do 7.5, you do 12 millimeter lateral, and which surgery is that? You operate on the muscle, but it's not for strabismus. That's the hint. Anybody wants to just answer? Try?
Ptosis surgery, ma'am. Supramaximal recession.
Where? Ptosis. What was that part?
Ptosis surgery, ma'am.
Ptosis. No, we don't operate on medial and lateral rectus and ptosis. That's a different department.
Okay.
Anybody? Quick. Okay, I will answer. It's nystagmus surgeries. Nystagmus surgeries, you do very large amounts of resections. And that is not strabismus really, but you still operate on the muscle. And that is one exception where you can and should do large amounts of surgeries. Okay, Adila, go ahead.
Yes. About the anesthesia, usually squint surgery is done under general anesthesia for children, uncooperative adults, in extensive surgery and surgery with complications. But it can also be done under topical anesthesia in a highly cooperative patient. Subtenous anesthesia can also be advised. Here the advantage is the eyeball motility is retained, so the squint correction can be checked on table itself. Retrobulbar and peribulbar anesthesia can also be advised. About force duction test, this is done preoperatively to reveal any restrictive pathology. repeated at various times during surgery can be done under topical anesthesia or general anesthesia, but not under local anesthesia. The conjunctiva is held at limpus with the fixation forceps without retracting the globe by pressure. Rather, the globe is pulled out to stretch the recti muscles and move the globe to the opposite direction of testing and note for any restriction of movement.
Let me just stop here 1 second and explain what she meant by topical and general, but not local. So topical, what happens is when you give a peribulbar block, we don't give retrobulbar blocks. When you give peribulbar blocks, sometimes the periorbital tissues are very tense and your FDD may be artificially different, may artificially be tight. So for that reason, what we do is if you're going to do a surgery under a peribulbar block, that is local anesthesia, then you may be better off doing the FDT first and then blocking the patient. That's what she means by that. And I think she's going to show a video of how to do an FDT. Go ahead.
Sorry, I'm only an image showing the
FDT. That's an image. Okay, not a problem. Go ahead. You describe what you're talking about. So what she already talked about. So basically at the limbus you hold, and important is for you to proptose the globe. If you are going to do an FDT for a rectus muscle, you have to proptose the globe, lift it up, and then pull away from the direction of where you think the restriction is to check whether there is a resistance to moving the globe. Whereas when you do for an oblique, then find out a lax oblique, then you retropulse the globe. We won't talk about that because that is something that comes under oblique surgery, and then we'll talk about FDT, the exaggerated post-duction test in that. But for recti, always remember, because in the exam, sometimes they'll ask you to describe, how do you do an FDT? As part of surgical discussion in the viva, then you should be able to say that you will grab by tooth forceps at the limbus and you will proptose the globe and then move the globe. Go ahead, Adila. Yes.
Conjunctival incisions. The various conjunctival incisions used are the limbal incision, fornix incision, over the muscle incision, paralimbal incision, and minimal incision strabismus surgery. The most commonly used is limbal incision of bone noden or fornix incision of parts. Fornix incision has the advantage of causing less trauma, less foreign body sensation. Dullness is uncommon. This preserves the conjunctival vasculature at the limbus. Suture closure of the incision is not required, and the incision is protected by the eyelid. It provides a better cosmesis. Conjunctiva at the limbus is preserved if a further glaucoma procedure is needed. Limbal incision has the advantage that more visualization of the tendon of muscle is possible. It is easy to understand. Release the conjunctival and the tenons tissue forces, suitable for en-bloc resection technique, and easier to perform adjustable suture. Whereas the disadvantages for fornix incision is it is difficult to comprehend, not release subconjunctival tissue bands or restriction. There is limited visualization, limited access to muscle, more difficult to perform suture adjustment. Limbal incision has the disadvantage of it disrupts the limbal vasculature, requires sutures to close. There is more foreign body sensation and dullness formation. In case of long-standing deviation and scars causing tight conjunctiva, conjunctival resection is done before closure. And if there is excess redundant conjunctiva, conjunctival resection is done before closing.
Okay, let me explain this. So she's talking of two things. One is the opening and the closing. The opening can be done in many, many ways. If you see, each one of us will have a slightly different way we operate. But classically, it's limbal, where you make an opening along the limbus, circumferential to the limbus, or fornix, where you go in the fornix and open and then access the muscle from a little long way. But the advantage of that is there's nothing visible in the palpebral fissure, and usually there is nice small little closure that you have to do with maybe even one or no stitches also. The next slide she talked about is closure, where you recess the conjunctiva also if you think the conjunctiva also is causing some amount of tethering, and some amount of the tightness is because of a tight conch, and which can happen in long-standing strabismus. Then you shorten the muscle, conjunctiva becomes excess, then you resect the conjunctiva. So that's what she talked about. Go ahead, and she can describe further about conjunctival apposition. Yeah.
about the instruments. The muscle hooks, the first is the Jennison's hook. This is a large muscle hook with a bulbous end, which ensures the muscle is completely secured. And this is second and third is the Green's hook, which is also a large muscle hook. The last one is the Von Griffey's hook. It does not have the bulbous end, just for lifting the muscle from the sclera. Other small hook is the Stevens hook. Other instruments like spring scissors, tenotomic scissors, curved and straight, retractor, Desmes retractor and deep tissue retractors, muscle resection clamp, artery clamp. And these are the needle holders, gastrovisual caliper, malleable iris repositor and tooth forceps. We use 60 vicryl polyglactin with 529 double arm spatulated needle for muscle suturing. For conjunctiva, 80 vicryl polyglactin is used. The various weakening procedures on recti include recession, which is of several types like conventional hangback or hemi-hangback, adjustable vertical transposition of horizontal recti and slanting recession, retroequatorial myopexy or Faden procedure, marginal myotomy, myectomy, free tenotomy or disinsertion. This image shows the various types of recession techniques. In this class, we'll confine our discussion to conventional recession technique.
Okay, hang on one second, Adila. Let me just comment a little bit about the instruments as well. Just go back quickly to the slide which showed the hooks. Right. So why do we need so many hooks? So when we first start hooking the muscle, you're not sure you have the entire muscle. So for those, you start with a Von Griffey hook, which does not have a knob in the tip, as you can see. Whereas if you look at the Jameson and the Green's hook, they have a little knob. So once you want to secure the muscle, after you are sure you have isolated the whole muscle, cleared the intermuscular septum and check ligaments, and now you want to really place the muscle with on a hook that will not allow the muscle to slip, then you choose one of these hooks. Go ahead, next. Okay. So this is a self-explanatory. Go to the next. So obviously when we do some of these surgeries, we are really working posteriorly, really long ways off from the limbus. And so you want to have good retraction. So Demar's retractor or a Barbie's retractor, these are all very good retractors available. Many of us don't use a resection clamp, but they will keep it in the exam. So please be familiar with it. A Demar's retractor will also be kept in the exam and on the tray. It's one of the most popular things that are asked. Please know about double eversion technique, know how you will use it, because that's not in strabismus, but still they will expect you to know how to do it. Next. Right. So again, very, very popular instruments on the instrument tray are the Castroviejo calipers. And they will also keep different needle holders, locking and non-locking. So a locking needle holder, the advantage is you can secure your needle, leave it, go make your mark, and then before the mark fades on the sclera, you can quickly start your bite, which is the advantage of a needle holder, which is locking. But the problem is you have to kind of unclick. Remember, otherwise you will be unclicking in the sclera, and that's, well, you know, scary. Now, another one of our favorite questions is, the Castroviejo caliper measures on a linear surface, right? But the globe is curved. So once you start going for longer and longer distances, how do you use the Castroviejo and still get accurate measurements? Because this is like measuring on a scale, right? Whereas the globe is actually curved. So any guesses? Meenakshi, do you want to take a guess at how else can you measure? Let's ask one of the fellows. How about that, Hena? How do you measure? Hena, I'm tired after a long OT. Let's see here. Pallavi, how do you measure? And of course, you have to measure long distances from the limbus.
Ma'am, through anatomical landmarks.
What landmark? There's nothing. medial rectus, there is insertion. After that, there is nothing. No landmark. You understand my question? It's easy if it is 5 millimeters. You can just, it's still valid.
Yes.
But once there is a curve, then your linear measurement is not valid. So how else can you measure? Well, there are two ways. One is you can split the distance and measure. You take the calipers. If it's 11 from the limbus, you measure 5.5. That is okay. Otherwise, there's something called the curved ruler. Scott's curved ruler. It was my mentor, Dr. Scott, who invented it. So I always feel a bit thrilled when I mention it. So this is Scott's curved ruler, which is marked according to the curvature of the globe. The whole ruler itself will have a little curvature with the markings on it. So that's one good way you can also use to measure. All right, next one. Next slide. Right. So again, a polygalactin suture, a vicryl, is always kept in the exam as in your instrument tray again. And you will typically be asked the nature of the suture. So you want to take a shot at this? Let's see. Who else do I know here? Radhika Sriram, do you want to take a shot at this? What? Tell me what type of suture is vicryl.
Absorbable suture.
It's an absorbable suture. Very good. Then, is it natural or is it
synthetic?
It's a synthetic suture. Very good. And so, why is it called vicryl? Any idea? That's just a silly question, actually. Why is it called vicryl?
It's obtained from that catgut of.
No, it's called vicryl because it's violet. Violet in color, and then it's an acrylic material. So it's basically it's a synthetic. Next question is: is it single or braided? Single strand or braided?
Single.
Braided, ma'am.
Braided.
Very good. Braided. Okay. Thanks, Ganesh. It is braided. So you have to be very careful when you handle the suture because it's braided. Sometimes it'll just start, you know, going into pieces. So good points. Next. Okay. So I think you started talking about a conventional recession. So yeah, go ahead with it.
After routine cleaning and draping, Barakar wire speculum is used to separate the lids. Lister forceps is used to grasp the limbal conjunctive and force duction test is done as described previously. And either fornix recession or fornix incision or limbal incision can be made. As ma'am has explained, fornix incision, it is made inferior temporal 8 millimeter or nasal 6.5 millimeter from the limbus. The conjunctiva is tented between the two forceps, and with the Westcott scissors, the incision is made, and the scissor blade is inserted into the incision, and the incision is extended. In case of a limbal incision, the globe is stabilized with the 260 silk sutures, and with the blade, the conjunctiva is penetrated, and then the Westcott scissors is inserted and expand the incision 3 clock hours and extend the incision by making radial cuts. Then with Manhattan forceps, the incision is held open. And first the Stevens stenotomy hook is passed under the rectus muscle, which is passed and then rotated 2 to 3 millimeter posterior to the insertion. Then the large Jemison's hook is passed, which spread the incision open with counter traction against the Stevens hook. Then superior pole of the muscle insertion is exposed with the Stevens muscle hook, and with Westcott scissors cut open the intermuscular septum and tenons capsule at the ball-like tip of the Jemison hook, and then pole test is done. So once the incision is extended, the Stevens hook is passed, followed by the Jemison's hook, and the intermuscular septum and the tenons capsule at the ball-like tip of the hook is incised with the Westcott scissors, and then the pole test is done. Through the incision made, through the opening made at the intermuscular septum, the Stevens hook is passed, and if we are able to pass it freely, that means the whole tendon is secured. Then the Westcott scissors used to cut the attachment between the subconjunctival tissue and the anterior insertion of the muscle, and then fine wire spatulated needle is passed through the tendon twice. Initially, partial sear bite is taken, and then after that, a full thickness bite is taken at the edge to form a loop of suture, and the lock knot is made. And then the muscle is cut at its original insertion. So So once the intermuscular septum tenons and all are cleared from the tip, the attachments, subconjunctival attachments are removed, and then the scleral, and then the incision is taken. First, the suture is passed through the center part, partial thickness bite is taken, and then full thickness bite is taken to form the double knot. Like similarly, it is done at both sides. And then the muscle is elevated and it is cut with the Westcott scissors at its original insertion. Then globe is stabilized with two gastrovisual locking forceps, and gastrovisual caliper is used to mark the sclera. And then a fine wire spatula tip needle is passed through the sclera. And here also double throw surgical knot is made to secure the muscle to the new insertion. So with the gastrovisual caliper, the marking is done, and then the scleral bite is taken and double throw a suture is taken and it is inserted to the new insertion. Then forceps removed, wound is swept closed with Stevens muscle hook, conjunctival edges are repositioned or swept closed. In case of a fornix incision, wound is not sutured. In limbal incision, conjunctiva is secured at the limbus with 2-8-0 vicryl suture. That's all.
I've anchored it on the sclera, conventional recession. Another one, I've hung it back from the insertion of the medial rectus. Sometimes we hang back, use the hang back technique for the recession. If the space is very, very less to operate, this was a 7-month-old baby. Can you see the screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you see the muscle video?
Yeah.
All right.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. So I'm not sure why this is an oblique finishing. So let me fast forward here. All right. So we're going to start the medial. As you can see, the medial rectus limbal incision with side cuts, relaxing incisions. Then an opening is made. Everything is grabbed, then a hook is slid inside. Okay, they irritated so rapidly, the hook went in and then the other hook also went in. All right. Now we're correcting, we are doing all the intermuscular septum and check ligaments. What are we measuring here? Why are we measuring here, Maitri?
Ma'am, if we are recessing, we are supposed to suture it there. So we are measuring the
distance. I'll give you a clue. It's an infantile ET patient. We don't always measure the insertion. Why do we measure? Why are we measuring the insertion of this patient? Because in infantile ET, the insertion of medial rectus is often anterior. Okay, so if you measure the amounts of recession from the insertion, you will undercorrect the patient. So the measurements are always made from the limbus. So we're just rechecking where is the insertion. Okay. All right. So now some clearing is going on. Placing partial thickness bite. Full thickness bite. And you can see there is a Barbie retractor there, giving me space. You can see the little retractor there on top. That's called a Barbie retractor. And then a locking bite on either poles. And then the muscle is disinserted. It was very, very tight. That's why you can see the hook is kind of flying off. It's a very tight. And you can see me measuring from the limbus. And then again, taking another measurement from there. You see space is kind of really less. So I've taken double space there. Now we are marking from the limbus, 11 millimeter from the limbus, a nice retraction. My assistant is showing a really nice, again marking from the limbus. Again from there, making another mark. And you can see it's just a bit anterior, maybe like 5. Again, another partial thickness scleral bite. And this is a conventional recession with bites on the sclera. Make sure the muscle is up. And put sutures, and then you close this with sutures in all the corners. Yeah, you tease the conjunctiva out and then it's closed in the corners. Okay, so let's contrast this with the other video, which is going to show a very similar limbal incision, but it's going to show a hangback. Again, I think he's starting with the inferior oblique. I'm going to fast forward. Yeah, it's still showing the inferior oblique. This patient needed inferior oblique weakening and needle rectus recession. Okay, now that's almost done. Right, so now we're starting medial rectus. Similar, again, conjunctival opening, limbal, very similar. So I'm going to fast forward. Again, you can see the same locking bites happening. Again, muscle is very tight. So I'm really careful. You can see the little hook that sister has inserted to give me some space, because I'm scared I'll cut the sclera because it's so tight. Again, you can see that the hook just flew. So I find there is no, and you can see that the bluish areas, because the muscle is so tight, it has been pressing on the sclera all these days. So here I'm passing it through the insertion and just see what happens. So I don't want to go there and fish around deep there. So now I pull the whole muscle up. I measure the amount of recession on the suture, place a locking needle holder, put all my bites and my throws on top, and then cut it. And now we just let the muscle slide back into position. As you can see, it's nicely slid back there. You see that I'm confirming that it's indeed what I wanted. And this one, this side is not as much. I'm pulling it a bit. And there you go. No tension of suturing in a very crowded space, in on the sclera, yeah, little baby, perforation, et cetera, et cetera. So this is an easy technique. The same thing, you would use it as a hangback, adjustable if you want to adjust the patient, and a bow tie or a sliding nose or one of the techniques. And then we close with 8-0 Vicryl, and that's it. Okay, so I think I'll stop sharing here as well. I apologize for not bringing the video of Phoenix. It's a very excellent video, many excellent videos actually. So perhaps, and as I told Adila, I said, let's not really crowd you with information. We will only look at preoperative considerations, and we will look at the surgery of recession alone this time. And we can take up resection and complications of strabismus surgery as another class later. And if Akila's there, Dr. Akila, my colleague, please make note of it. Any questions from anybody before we wrap up? Very well done, Adila, very happy. Yes, Dr. Akila is there. So if you could at some point have another class of resection techniques, strengthening techniques for recti with, along with complications, that could be another class whenever it happens. Any questions from anybody before we wrap up?
Can I add just one small point?
Please do.
You all must have seen that we sometimes do 2-3 muscles in one eye, right? So when we do oblique and recess, resect, which order do we follow? Is it my choice, or is there a meaningful order? Anybody wants to answer? Is there a reason we choose a particular order when we operate on more than one muscle in one eye? A fellow maybe? Henna?
Ma'am, we would like to do an oblique first, because ma'am, like when we are recessing oblique, we are recessing it in relation to the lateral rectus, like taking measurements from there, or when we are doing anterior transposition in relation to the actual insertion of the recti muscles. And then we go in for the horizontal recti muscles.
Very good. The first point is, in relation, obliques do not have, like, we can't measure the way we measure for horizontal recti. So one reason is, yes, as a reference, we need the recti. Another reason, See, another reason is we choose this order of oblique first because obliques we need more manipulation, right? So we manipulate the eye more, we have to bring down, up and all that. So we want more manipulation first so that we go into the other muscles which require less manipulation. So the first reason, like Henav said, for reference, we need the recti, so we operate obliques first. In recess and resect, which one do we do first?
And we prefer to recess first.
Very good. Any reason?
I'm not sure. I've just always seen everybody recess first.
I feel, yeah, we do recess first. Again, the same reason. In resection, what do? We shorten a muscle, right? So we shorten a muscle to quite an extent sometimes that after we do that, we don't want further manipulations in the eye. So that is why we do in this order. So if there are obliques and horizontal recti, we choose the obliques first. And if there are recess and resection in one eye, then we choose the recessions first, followed by resection. It may vary when we do resurgeries. But in aversion surgery, this is how we do. So this is what I just wanted to order. Otherwise, the presentation is wonderful.
Thanks. Thanks, Kavita. Do you want to add anything? Any of the fellows, Akila, Muthumina, anybody wants to add any points? Please feel free.
No, ma'am.
Question.
Yes, please.
Ma'am, when we document anterior segment ischemia, I mean, how do we manage the patient?
Anterior segment ischemia, first you have to find out why. Sometimes it may just be that you've not operated on too many muscles, but you might have placed a suture, say like a posterior fixation or a Fardin suture, on one of the critical blood vessels. So if you can identify what has caused the anterior segment ischemia, then you go back, and if it's a Fardin suture, you take it off. That's the first thing you do, take it out.
Okay.
That itself may help the eye starting to recover. Otherwise, you have to put the patient on topical and systemic steroids. You have to monitor the IOP. You'll have to give them something for pupillary dilation, because these patients can have anterior chamber reaction, can have hypotony, corneal edema. So that's how you have to manage them. You want to add something, Kavita?
Nothing. No, I was just going to ask, how do you identify? How do you identify or suspect that if a patient has anterior segment ischemia? You can answer. You asked about how to manage, so you yourself can answer. How do we identify?
Yeah, I think the patient will have anterior segment, anterior chamber reaction, and corneal edema will be there.
Oh, Gajendra. Okay.
The patient will have pain also, ma'am. So.
We routinely probably do not do a slit lamp examination for post squint surgery patients, but when you do, a lot of surgeries, like you do a transposition and you have done a surgery where you might expect, reaction to be more, then it is a good practice to try to see an anterior segment slit lamp examination even for post strabismus surgery patients. That is how you will probably pick it up.
This was not exactly absolutely right, Kavita. This was not exactly relevant to today's topic, but
we haven't talked.
No, I have not finished my sentence. I'm saying, good to say. Post-operative care we haven't discussed. So I wanted to add, just to continue what you've already said, other reason that you must examine on slit lamp, other than looking for anterior segment ischemia, is also sometimes long surgeries, you won't realize, but the epithelium may have become loose, or epithelium, the corneal surface may have become dry. So when you see the patient is in too much pain than what you expect, or is severely photophobic and not willing to open the eye, then you must always examine them on slit lamp and look for any epithelial abnormality. And like Kavita was saying, if you anticipate anterior segment ischemia, of course you should do a good slit lamp examination.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Anybody else has any questions? I know several of you may not have seen a strabismus surgery yet. Many of you, I see many new names as well. So you will. I hope today's class you were able to understand the steps, because this is a very, very commonly done surgery in the pediatric department. and you will usually definitely always get to see. I don't know about the post-COVID lull that we have, but usually you'll always get to see recessions and even participate in recessions, you know, do steps of the recession when you are posted in pediatric. So if there are no further questions from anybody, I really, really thank my colleagues who have joined for the class, despite this being a long day. And I thank Adila for a wonderful job. And again, I thank Akila, and particularly Hena, who I was driving crazy to get me the videos. So thank you so much. And
thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.